Of the Committee on Racing, Gaming, and Wagering for the Senate. I'm joined by Senator Marchione, who's a member of our committee, as well as our ranker, Senator Dabo. I want to thank all of our invited guests that are here. I'd like to wish everyone a healthy and happy new year. And I just would like to make a couple preliminary remarks, if I may. When we set this legislative hearing up about a week ago, we didn't realize that as of a couple days ago, The governor has called a meeting at his mansion at 12:30 for a budget briefing. That does not mean we're not going to be discourteous to anyone here that's coming to testify today. We have four speakers, and I have three written responses of individuals that will not be here today. So let me start by putting in the record the testimony from three organizations and individuals, and to say that we will accept written submissions until the close of business on Friday, January 20th. We have a written report from Christopher Kay, the president and CEO of the New York Racing Association, but he has elected not to testify today. Kevin Fitzgerald, the deputy mayor of the Incorporated Village of Floral Park, and Patricia Velusic, president of the New York State Humane Association. When we do start, we're going to ask Jeffrey Caninzo, the executive director of the New York Thoroughbred Breeders, to be first, and we're going to ask Joe McMahon to come up of Saratoga Thoroughbreds LLC to join him. The reason we're calling this meeting today is that Senator Marchione has been a strong advocate for the reprivatization of NYRA. And she's particularly concerned with the Saratoga racetrack, but I'm particularly concerned with all the breeders and the effect on all of the horsemen in the state of New York. So I think this is a very important legislative hearing. And I'd like to start off by saying that I was disappointed last year, both Senator Marchione and I, with the governor trying to reduce by approximately $13 million the money to NYRA. NYRA and the horse racing industry and the breeders are responsible for direct and indirect about 33,000 jobs. This goes to retainage of jobs. At the same time, when the governor wants to cut monies from NYRA, which affects the agricultural industry, which I'm very concerned with as a as something upstate, which is our most important industry, by the way, in the state of New York, the governor has invested $420 million in the film tax credit, which is mainly for the metropolitan area, although lately it's been expanded to the Mid-Hudson. He's invested in the Empire State development and startup, which is 408 jobs, and just in the advertising budget alone for that program, he has spent $53 million. So I'm not here to beat the governor up. I supported budgets of the film tax credit. I think the movie industry has a tremendous impact in revenues in the state of New York, and I was a supporter of startup. And I know these kinds of things take time to implement. But why am I bringing these things up? It shows in my mind what's a priority with this governor. What's important? What is he setting at his priorities? And when he's investing these kinds of monies in the film tax credit, he's investing these kind of monies in startup, and he wants to cut the horsemen and breeders $13 million, where in the past 2 years they've been doing quite well, NYRA showing a profit, I'm concerned about it. So they're my preliminary remarks, and now I'd like to turn it over to Senator Marchione.
Thank you, Senator Bonnetak, and let me first say thank you to you for being willing to have this hearing. It is very important. I'd like to thank those who are here testifying, both written and orally here today, especially those from my own home district. I appreciate your participation. Certainly, we are here today to consider the future of the New York Racing Association, and it's a critical issue of importance, not just to Saratoga, as our chairman has said, but to all of New York State. It's estimated that New York's equine industry has nearly $4.2 billion effect on the state's economy. We heard from the chairman about 33,000 full-time jobs, but it also generates $187 million in state and local taxes. Without question, horse racing is vitally important for Saratoga County, our capital region, but all of New York State. New York State needs to keep its promise made years ago to return NYRA to private control as a reorganized not-for-profit. Many stakeholders in the racing industry have real concerns over horse racing's future if action isn't taken to honor this promise. The reality is that key long-term decisions on important issues and critical multi-million dollar investments are being delayed until NYRA is reprivatized as a nonprofit. This perpetual state of limbo for NYRA isn't serving any practical purpose. In fact, it's doing real harm. The continued delay comes at a price, and the cost to our racing industry and economy could exceed tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of dollars. 2017 must be the year that New York State finally honors its promise to NYRA, so that NYRA can move forward as a reprivatized nonprofit and with the financial formula going forward as previously negotiated in the franchise agreement. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I look forward to listening to the compelling testimony today.
Thank you, Senator. We're joined by Senator Boyle, Senator Dabo has some opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and your staff and Senator Marchione for doing this hearing today and for those participants on what is a truly very important issue for our state, as was described by our chair. I live in the shadows of Aqueduct. I was born and raised in Ozone Park, where Aqueduct sits. And so for my better part of my adult life, and my years as city council, and certainly now as a state senator, I've been dealing with NYRA. What I'd like and hope for this process as we go forward and we hear testimony, we work out these issues throughout this legislative year, I am hoping for a pragmatic, cautious approach, because change for the sake of change is not going to help our state. It's not going to help the breeders or the horsemen. It's change for the sake of better, that the end result is better than what we have now, if that should be the case. So I look forward to working with all. I look forward to working with my good chair, Senator Bonasek, and I want to acknowledge the presence of my colleague here, Senator Lee Wertheimer from Queens. Thank you very much.
Okay. We're going to start now, and Jeffrey Canincio, I'm going to ask to come up, and Joe McMahon, which are already at the head table. Okay, you're on. Go ahead.
I'll go ahead and make my remarks first, and Jeff has a lot of information to back up this stuff. My name is Joe McMahon. I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to address this panel. I've been involved in the thoroughbred horse industry since the mid-60s. I, along with my wife, Ann, purchased a farm in Saratoga Springs, New York in 1972. Since that time, we have raised well over 1,000 racehorses, which have gone on to win numerous races, including the Kentucky Derby in 2003, won by a horse who many of you may well remember, Funny Side, the only New York bred to win the Kentucky Derby. Breeders in New York State have proved that they can raise a top horse. Our racing facilities are the best in the world. We have the best breeding incentive program in the country, and horse sales have risen precipitously over the past 5 years. New York is looking bright, or one would think so. Maybe not. Professional horse people from around the country know how good it is here in New York State. but there is something holding the industry back. There are potential investors, breeders, and owners from around the country who are ready to invest large sums of money in New York State. But there is a lingering concern that politics is threatening what is becoming a vibrant industry for our state. People are reluctant to invest in bricks and mortar in New York State because they don't feel that the state government is a trustworthy partner. Negative events of the last several years, including the state government control of the New York Racing Association, which was supposed to last only 2 years, but has dragged on for almost 4 years, is likely the biggest cause for mistrust an apparent backroom deal, which took millions of dollars, tens of million dollars from the racing industry, has and will continue to cause more distrust when its full impact becomes clear later this year. Other problems include persistent talk of closing Aqueduct Racetrack without another stated plan for continued winter racing. A failed legislative attempt to curb the ever-escalating cost of racetrack insurance. And thirdly, the licensing of a new casino which has no condition in it to protect the existing breeding and racing industry and its neighbor Finger Lakes Racetrack. All of these problems are undermining the confidence needed for the thoroughbred industry to grow. It is perfectly clear, no matter what industry you are involved in, business people do not invest where there is uncertainty and an environment lacking in trust. There needs to be a long-term commitment that the state of New York will be a good partner with racing. If and when that commitment becomes reality, the potential for growth in breeding and racing increases tremendously. New York State has a tradition of racing going back to colonial times. Saratoga Racetrack is the crown jewel in all of American racing. The three tracks which make up the New York Racing Association, Aqueduct, Belmont, and Saratoga, produce the highest betting handle in the country. We also have the largest purse structure of any racetrack in operation today. Why don't we build on this? Why don't we take this position and use it wisely? If the horse industry is going to survive and prosper in New York State, we need to have positive action to show that New York State has a plan that is free of political interference. Racing needs to be treated like the great business it is, not left to wither and die like many of our upstate factories. The legislation must act now to fix this. How do we fix this? Immediately, New York State government should get out of the racing business. The state should be a nurturing force, not an obstacle to growth. Number two, we should honor the existing franchise agreement. Number three, a new board of directors from NIRO should be made up of active stakeholders from the thoroughbred horse industry, each with full voting privileges. And fourthly, the New York Racing Association needs to be returned to private hands immediately. I thank you very much for your time, and if you have any questions, Jeff will make his presentation and we'll go from there.
What I'd like to do is have Jeff speak, and then if any member of our racing committee can direct any questions to either Jeff or Mr. McMahon. Jeff.
Thank you, Senators, for allowing the New York Breeders' Fair to testify. We greatly appreciate your interest and desire to correct the situation and move this industry forward. I have a PowerPoint that I'm going to reel through as fast as possible in the essence of all of the things that we've outlined. So I'm going to get right into this. Who are we? the New York breeders. We were founded in 1974. We're the official representation of the breeding industry here in New York to protect and promote it. And it's that simple. We're here to advocate for the thousands of people that are breeding and owning horses here in the state of New York. Why are we important? Well, the numbers that you referenced earlier were part of a study that was done back at the end of 2011 and 2012. And it showed a few things that are critical in showing how big business we really are to the state of New York. We have a $4.2 billion effect on the state's GDP. That's pretty big. There's 33,000 people that are full-time employees of this industry that across all the parts of the state of New York. There's 1.38 million acres of farmland that are used for equine facilities here in the state. It's a lot of green space. We generate, as Senator Marchione mentioned, $187 million in annual tax revenue back to the state in many different forms of taxes. And one of the bigger pieces of this, too, is that the equine industry, believe it or not, has a reach in every single county in the state of New York, which is very, very unique to any industry that can talk about that. So the point is, we're big business. That's why we're important. I think it's important to understand, you know, how we got to where we are. And I think we'd be negligent if we didn't talk about the past. And I'm going to quickly run through this. But in 2004 to 2011, New York's foal crop was suffering dramatic decreases. There was 25% of the farms in the state, roughly about 100 of them, closed. 33% of the broodmare population left the state of New York. 34% of our foal crop dropped year to year to year. We had a drop in our stallion population by more than 57%. And based on the economics of this, we believe we lost about 4,000 jobs from the equine industry out of New York from 2004 to 2011. And as you can see, our foal crop was, at that point, the smallest it had ever been in over a decade. You fast forward till today. New York has become one of the largest breeding states in the country. We've grown from right under 5% of the national foal crop to roughly 7.1% that this was done in 2004, the last time the Jockey Club had a full set of years, full crop figures. Dramatic increase. So people are coming to the state of New York to breed and own horses. Our New York bred full crop rose 33% from 2011 to 2015. What's important with that? We're the only state in the country that had growth from those years, year over year to year. The only state. In 5 years' time, from a quality standpoint, we've accomplished some of the highest accolades in racing. 17 Grade 1 winners, 2 Breeders' Cup champions, 5 Eclipse Award finalists. So the point is that people are coming here and they're exceeding in excellence. It's important to understand the relationship between gaming and racing and how that affects, you know, where this economic impact actually comes from. So gaming contributes by statute and contractual agreements to purses in the breeding funds. Those purses in the breeding funds are what funnel our industry economics and all the things we're talking about. So breeders and the supply of and veterinary care and farmland and their investments come from purses in the funds. Owners who continually buy our product and are racing it and investing in the racetrack of horses itself and the racetracks themselves that are generating handle all come from purses in the funds, which are the direct connection to gaming. That's what this relationship is. And at the end of the day, it triggers off the employment that what we have, and that's where you see this $4.2 billion effect and 33,000 jobs. In 2015, I want to look at where breeders were based on racetrack, and this is going to demonstrate the importance of aqueduct and what it means to the breeders and the horsemen and to NARA itself. But roughly 47% of all of the breeder awards that are distributed by NARA are earned at aqueduct over the winter meet. The number of awards, you can see the Finger Lakes story, which is a segue into a little bit different than this, but 49% of the number of awards earned at Finger Lakes, but again, 24% of the awards occur at Aqueduct. So the point is that Aqueduct is critically important to the breeding landscape and to the horseman's landscape here in racing, which is a major part of where NYRA goes in the future. This next chart really quickly is the number of races, and the simple takeaway from this is that 32% of Aqueduct's races are for state-bred horses, okay, which is 39% of all of the state-bred races that happen in the state. So 39% of all of our state's New York-bred races occur at Aqueduct Racetrack. Quickly, the starts, this is actually a staggering figure. So 55% of all of the horse population that races at New York State racetracks, this includes Finger Lakes, is made up of New York bred horses. So the point of this is that without this New York breeding program, there is no racing as we know it in New York State. Just as such that if there is no racing, there is no breeding program to support it, and down goes the agribusiness that we've talked about at length here already. The specifics to the NYRA reorg. This may sound trivial, but it's actually important. Participation. We have the most skin in the game, the people sitting right here at this table. We're the owners and breeders and the people invested in this industry. We're the investors to what we're talking about. That's why our participation is important. We want to be a part of the committee. We want to be part of the stakeholders. We want to be a part of NYRA. Again, it sounds trivial, but not necessarily based on where we are today. The time is now. As we advocate for a larger plan from NYRA, we need to be doing this, as Joe has mentioned, and you at the Senate has mentioned. This cannot wait any longer. The cloud that has loomed over our industry needs to disappear, because that's when investment will really start into New York. Right now, we're not seeing that because of the overarching uncertainty that surrounds us. Protecting racing and breeding share of gaming revenue. Last year's budget included sweeps of VLT funds that were related to our industry. We're looking to create a hard floor, something that we can budget to and plan for based on the actuals of gaming revenue that we're receiving. And we want a commitment for this franchise for that revenue, such that people don't have to worry about what is at stake or what is down the road. That's the biggest problem that we have. We don't know what's going to happen year to year with racing. There's no business in the state of New York that can operate that way. We need long-term plans. You know, the breeding industry is such that you're not producing a foal that's going to race tomorrow. It takes 3 years for that cycle to happen. So these people need to be able to plan to that. This is a critically important piece that I want to talk about. It's last year's budget, and the night before the budget was released, there was a deal that was struck that essentially is allowed Genting at Aqueduct to operate 1,000 VLT machines for Nassau County OTB. By statute, Nassau County OTB was permitted to have these 1,000 machines. It was done so in the commercial gaming law several years ago. They've had issue year over year of actually finding a place for them to go. So in the budget, they said that Genting can house these. Very vague language other than the fact that Genting could do so. This went through the entire calendar year. It went through Gaming Commission approval. An MOU was struck this fall. And in October, Genting essentially didn't add 1,000 machines. It took 460 of the racing industry's machines. Okay, so we just lost 460 machines. Well, what does that mean? And the key to this is they didn't just take any machine. They took the highest grossing 460 machines. So the machines and how they generate revenue, it's based on something called win per machine, WPM. And it's basically how much money comes back into the cycle or which ones do the best. They took the 460 best machines. Well, what does that mean to us? It's a $20 million loss to NYRA, to the purse account, and to the breeding fund. It's broken down for you right there. That's a projection based on real numbers. We took what they've done from October to December, and if you forecast that into 2017, It's a $20 million loss that will occur to this industry. At a time when we're trying to reorganize NYRA, when we're trying to create certainty, this is the absolute opposite of what was supposed to happen. Now, you know, at the same time, it's interesting to point out of every one of those 460 machines that Genting is labeled as Nassau, Genting gets paid 8% more. So Genting is making out very well in every machine that they take and label for Nassau. Meanwhile, we're losing. We don't believe that was the intent of this structure that was done the last night of the budget, but it needs to be addressed. This is the most critical, immediate effect that our racing industry has here across the state of New York. We need to come out with some type of arrangement where the horsemen and breeders and NYRA are protected going into the future, which ties back into what I was talking about. Critically important to this situation. Race day integrity, very quickly. The breeders and horsemen need to be involved. We need our consent on the number of races that occur throughout the year. Just like any other industry, any other sports franchise across the country, if the participants are not involved with making decisions about the calendar year, negative things can happen. I showed you the numbers on why Aqueduct and winter racing are important to this landscape. We need to be a part of determining the calendar year for racing here across the state of New York. It's that simple. If we don't have a seat at the table to do so, it creates problems economically for the people that are a part of this industry. And again, stakeholders. You know, we want to be voting full members of the board. Currently, Mr. Violet and myself are ex officio members, NYFA and NYTB, on the NYRA franchise under the governor's reorganization board. Prior to the reorganization board, we were full-fledged voting members of NYRA. That changed. There's no reason that your stakeholders with the biggest stake and investment in this industry shouldn't have full-fledged voting rights on that board. It's something that we've been actively pursuing. It's something that the Senate introduced last year as well. We hope that that continues to happen here going forward. That is my presentation as quickly as I could do it. Thank you, and again, we'll answer any questions that you have.
Does anyone have any questions of either of the two gentlemen? Mm-hmm.
Good.
Yes, Leroy.
Good morning. I'm Senator Leroy Comrie. I represent parts of Elmont and technically Belmont Park, along with the eastern part of Queens. And I was concerned on a couple of things that you said. I appreciate both of you gentlemen's testimony. What are the new challenges facing the state regarding the industry? You said that you earlier said the industry is moving up, that breeding is going up. Do you see any, and that investors around the country are ready to come to a stable environment that you need to have? And I appreciate that testimony. It makes a lot of sense to me that we need to have a consistent program in the state to ensure that there can be continued investment. How do you see the racing industry nationally? Is it continuing to expand, or is New York leading the way?
I think we both can answer this. I think we should both could take a shot too. Really, my two cents on that is that, you know, nationally our industry is contracting somewhat. But the unique part is that people have, based on those figures, have come to New York. The only reason that there was growth is that people from out of state were coming to New York State to operate under our incentive programs. The issue is, some of the largest, most commercial operations across the country were just taking a step into New York, meaning they brought a horse here, or they allowed someone else to operate their business here. The difference is that they could be fully invested in New York. If there were certainty down the road, we'd see more farmland purchased by out-of-state entities. We'd see larger racing operations. We'd see more horsemen in New York. And again, it goes back to the uncertainty is that people have dabbled in New York, which is why we've seen marginal growth. we could see those numbers dramatically increase if there was some type of certain forecast for the next 25 years for raising.
And can you delve down into the, you said that the state took 460 VLT machines from Aqueduct to as opposed to the 1,000 machines that were supposed to come in. Can you drill down into that a little bit more?
Sure. So the budget that was done, the statute was done last March, permitted Genting to operate 1,000 machines for Nassau County OTB.
Right. Additional machines.
Additional.
Right.
That was the intent. That is the plan that's been communicated to us. Since that point, we've written various letters between the Horsemen's organization and ours to the state, to the Gaming Commission, asking the details of how they're going to implement those 1,000 machines, of which we found out in the fall that Genting took, so they currently had 5,500 machines, for example. Rather than becoming 6,500 machines, they took 460 of our 5,500 machines that we get paid on and allocated them for Nassau. So the percentages by statute that we receive from Nassau are fractional to what we receive from Genting. And the bigger issue to that is that they cherry-picked the best ones, okay? Which they take the best machines, Genting gets paid 8% more on those machines, we get paid significantly less. So that's where the $20 million loss comes from if you add it in collectively across our industry for that.
So the new machines haven't been brought in yet?
No. There's not one new machine. They've relabeled or reallocated 460 machines. And the scary part is that's only half of the 1,000 that's been done by statute. So this problem could be worse.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Just, if I may, you have furnished the written report of your testimony, and it will be available to all of the members of the Racing Committee on the Senate side. But can we get a copy of your PowerPoint presentation?
Absolutely.
Okay, fine. I have no further questions of these two gentlemen other than to suggest that as you were testifying, the governor has just announced that he will have a privatization plan concerning NYRA. I don't know all of the details, but as we're scanning quickly, it looks like we're going in the right direction. But again, we have to wait till the dust settles. Anyone have any questions of these two gentlemen? Hearing none, we thank you. And our next speaker will then be Richard Violet Jr., who's president of the New York State Thoroughbred Horsemen's Association. And I will say that the breeders' interests are pretty much in line with the horsemen's interest. And I noticed that you have not given any written testimony, and I don't know if it's your intention to do so or not, but we're pleased that you're here to give oral testimony. Richard, go ahead.
Thank you so much for having us, and I'd like to say ditto and let's all go home. On most points I could, I'd like to elaborate on a few. What I was planning to do was come in and be somewhat oratorial and try to drum down. We are New York Racing. There's a definition that sometimes gets confused. We get lumped in with the racetracks. And, you know, Belmont Park is a great place, but without the horses and the people who buy them, breed them, support them, it's a great place to practice yodeling. It'd be pretty empty. Yankee Stadium's a great building. Without the guys in pinstripes, it's a pretty boring place to go to watch, you know, three empty bases and an empty home plate. Without the Riveras and the Derek Jeters, it's not really Yankee Stadium. Excuse me. So, frankly, we are the Yankees of New York Racing. Theater district, empty playhouse without the players, the producers, people who play everything. And you also don't go to the Majestic Theater operation to negotiate if you want Helen Hayes to star in your play. You have to go to Helen Hayes' managers, producers, the people who put on the show. And that's the differentiation here. while we also agree that NYRA should be privatized ASAP, fixing NYRA's issues doesn't necessarily fix the horsemen or the breeders' issues, as underlined by the VLT. And this is insanely unfair to the industry. It started out bad when they were going to have 1,000 machines, even in Nassau County and Suffolk County. Racing got zero. NYRA got nothing. Breeders got nothing. And it's hard to think that it got worse than that. But it's got worse, nuclear worse than that. The 2013 floor wasn't even a hard floor for the horsemen. It is for breeders. It is for NYRA. It isn't for the breeders or the horsemen. We only start to get a 2.3% part of those Nassau County OTB machines if we fall below 2013 levels. We would never catch up at that rate. It still got worse because they couldn't find a place to house their 1,000 machines. Oh, it's a great idea. We'll allocate new 1,000 machines at Aqueduct to bail out Nassau County OTB. Well, nobody, and that's why the floor was supposedly established, in case the cannibalization from 6 miles away or 8 miles away started to hurt the revenue that was coming in at Aqueduct. Nobody ever envisioned, or some clairvoyant, very clever people envisioned, a direct competitive machine-by-machine cannibalization. And it's even worse than that. We lost 10% of the machines. They didn't build 500 new machines. They're not going to build 1,000 new machines. The fact of the matter is there's even a bigger incentive for Genting to add that remaining 560 machines, because then when they get to 1,000, they actually get 4 points from education for their capital projects. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's so outrageous. So they would get 1,000 machines where they go from 22% of that machine's handle, the drop every day, they go from 22 to 30%. So if I'm them, I'm doing the 1,000 machine as possible. They get to cherry pick and pick the best, and I mean, it's a science on casino floors, where the positioning of machines and everything. The net per machine before any changes were made with the Nassau County OTB machines was about $440 per machine over those 5,500 machines. Since they divided it up, the $460 and the $5,000 that was made original, that those $460 machines are earning in the 900s. That's how much the cherry picking makes a difference. Instead of losing, maybe if it was a blended rate, 10%, we lost 500 machines, we're going to lose 10. We're losing close to 33% of the revenue. We went from 440, 450 to 320, 330. And like Jeff said, it can get worse. They can go ahead and do the 1,000 machines because the incentive is huge. Another to get 1 point from the existing Nassau County machines for their capital improvement, and they'll get another 4 points. That actually comes out of education if they expand to that 1,000 machines. There is nothing equitable. There is nothing fair about this whole setup. We rewarded failed behavior after failed behavior, and racing is supporting it. Racing is now going to get Nassau County OTB out of debt. They owe racing $9 million. We're going to get paid back with our own revenue. Just because they're going to take from Peter and pay NYRA is what it is. This has to have serious review. It was done 11th hour in the budget last year. The MOU was done in a cave somewhere with candlelight, and it came out. I mean, it isn't appropriate. It isn't fair. It just isn't the way. It's bad business in New York. We're always fighting to get people in here to do business. And in an industry, and just very gratified. You guys get it. You lady. I hope I'm preaching to the people who aren't as initiated, who aren't as interested in our industry. But the second largest agri-industry in the state has to get more attention than we do. We see on the front page of whatever business section, 40 new jobs, somebody's expanding. Saab, 250 jobs in Syracuse or wherever. Nationally, 700 jobs for Ford in the Midwest. We got 33,000 jobs. We should, government in New York State should be doing everything to help us expand, to help our growth. Not retard it, but these insane little codicils and this domino effect. $12 million. Everybody was in uproar over Naira losing $12 or $13 million. Purses will lose $10 to $12 million alone. At the present state, that could multiply. There's no telling. There's no equation that I can come up with that can tell you what the loss will be per machine if they add another 560. That metric, we have no idea because we don't know what those next 560 machines are going to net. Maybe we drop below 300, which would be catastrophic. There seems to be a consensus that we're a viable industry, but it's not. It's in this room. It's not statewide, and it really, really is. It's alarming and really confusing why we don't. And I hate the word respect. It's been halfway demonized. Not looking to pick a fight. But we don't get the attention that a major industry and the players that the breeders represent and that the horsemen represent. We are New York Racing. Our membership invests in the horses, hires the grooms, hires the hot walkers, the farriers, the dentist, and they all go to the deli and the, you know, the dry cleaners, the gas station, the pizzerias. It is our constituency that is the meatballs on this plate with spaghetti. And hopefully this will be incorporated into what the privatization of Naira means. We talked about racing dates. We have to be a seat at the table so that there is common sense used when you're determining how many racing dates, how many available dates there are. Frankly, we're the only horsemen's group in the country that doesn't have a contract with its sitting racetracks. Even Finger Lakes has a contract. So these are things that need to be on the table going down the road. I really appreciate the time, and I know you have bigger things to do and more important places, but thank you so much for your time.
Richard, thank you. We never have bigger things to do because this is very important, mm-hmm. and this is big. Does anyone have any questions of Mr. Violin? Okay.
Thank you
very much. Our next two speakers I'm going to ask to come up is Todd Shimkus, is president of the Saratoga County Chamber of Commerce, and he will be joined by Cynthia Hollowood, who's a board member of the Saratoga Racecourse Community Advisory Board. We welcome you both. Todd, do you want to start?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senators. I've got four slides. Cindy has one. I can do my four slides in 5 minutes.
Okay.
So I will. I'll get right into it.
Quickly,
the Concerned Citizens for Saratoga Racing was formed in part with the Chamber of Commerce, Saratoga County Chamber of Commerce in 2006. Who are we? We're hoteliers, we're breeders, chiropractors, racing fans, restaurateurs, retirees. We're famous announcers. Tom Durkin is on our group, and he's here today. We're veterinarians, chamber members, farmers, bankers, realtors. We are citizens of Saratoga Springs who care deeply about our community. Here's an interesting, we think, chart for you about pro sports here in New York State. Up on the board, Thoroughbred Horse Racing is Saratoga's professional sports franchise, and the Saratoga Racecourse is a defining feature of our history, culture, quality of life, and our global brand. Today, the Saratoga Racecourse, in a city with just 28,000 people, draws more paid attendance in one season than any of New York State's other sports franchises. We're talking about the Knicks, the Nets, the Sabres, the Islanders, the Rangers, the Giants, the Jets, and the Bills.
Really?
You can look at this chart. More people come to Saratoga for our 40-day meet than due to those home stadiums in the course of those seasons. So maybe not the Mets and the Yankees, but everybody else we compete with. Saratoga's average daily paid attendance is higher than the Knicks, the Nets, the Sabres, Islanders, and Rangers. In fact, you could combine a few of them, and they still wouldn't equal the daily average that we have in paid attendance at the Saratoga Racecourse. So we think it's a pretty significant sports industry as well as an agricultural industry that deserves people's respect and some accommodations. The revenues legally owed to horse racing must go to horse racing. New York State must honor the existing court-approved franchise agreement. And up on the chart now you can see a number of years ago in 2008, as a result of the franchise agreement, New York State, kind of like buying a home, took ownership of $1 billion in land. It could be worth more today because certainly things have improved since that time. In return, New York State promised and signed a contract that was approved by the federal bankruptcy courts that said that VLT revenues in specific percentages would be returned to all of the industries, all of the stakeholders that Jeff and Rick and Joe already spoke about. That agreement, that contract, that promise needs to be upheld. Why reprivatization of NYRA as a not-for-profit corporation is the best and only option. The other two, quickly, one is that the state continues to control it. And even the governor said that he knows that that's not a long-term venture for the government to run. The other is we could sell all of the tracks, including Saratoga, to the highest bidder and have a private industry take that over. As Tom Durkin pointed out on June 15th, the third option is the state could sell Saratoga, and that is not necessarily going to keep our community's best interest at heart. So we believe the not-for-profit corporation is the best and only option. Here's the best part of why that is. All of the stakeholders, the public sector, the private sector, the stakeholders that you heard from already today, community leaders in places like Saratoga, we can all be in the room where it happens. We can all be a part of the decision-making and work together. A not-for-profit corporation is the only option that allows for stakeholders and communities that have a vested interest to be at that table, to be in that room. And that's why we believe that is the best and the only option for New York State going forward. And now I'll turn it over to Cindy to talk about some specifics.
Before you do, could we get a copy of that PowerPoint for every member?
I emailed it to Andrew this morning.
Okay, fine.
Absolutely.
My last remark, and it's directed to our next speaker. You have given us written reports.
Yes.
So I would ask you not to read anything there because...
All right, I'll just read off the slide then. Because
we've all read it, and if you could condense your remarks
of
your highlights, we would appreciate it.
Great. I'm happy to do that. I'm Cindy Hollywood. I've been the general manager of the Holiday Inn in Saratoga Springs for 35 years. I also serve on the Saratoga Racecourse Community Advisory Board, which is comprised of local representatives from the City of Saratoga Springs, Saratoga County, and the New York Racing Association. Before I talk about our interest and the comments from our advisory board, I just want to tell you a little bit about the economic impact that racing has on my business, which I've run, as I mentioned, 35 years. Since our opening in 1964, we have benefited from the premier racing that Saratoga, that the New York Racing Association brings to Saratoga Racecourse. Racing season room revenues account for more than 30% of our total room revenues. Our hotel occupancy is 30% higher when racing is in town. Our restaurant revenues are 35% higher during the summer meet than the remainder of the year. Our hotel collects $355,000 in occupancy tax in 2015. 35% of that came from our racing season dates. And I only represent about 7% of the number of hotel rooms in all of Saratoga County, not just Saratoga Springs. Annually, we spend in excess of $1 million making improvements on our facility as a result of the profits we receive from racing season, and we hire all Saratoga County contractors. Many of the jobs that are created for racing in the Saratoga region pay well above that $15 an hour level that is such a hot topic these days. And our Saratoga Racecourse Community Advisory Board firmly believes that only through the promised reprivatization can the future of thoroughbred racing in New York State be improved and enhanced. And we believe that the capital improvements and enriched fan experience, as well as the maintenance and sustainability of an aging physical plant at Saratoga, can only be enhanced by this reprivatization. If the next generation of racing fans is to be encouraged and attracted, we are convinced that the bipartisan bill that was passed last year to return NYRA to the private sector must move forward expeditiously this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone have any questions of our two speakers? Okay. Does anyone have any closing remarks? Senator Boyle?
Just would like to welcome our colleague from the committee, Senator Sanders from Queens.
Okay. Senator Boyle.
I would just like to thank the chairman for holding this important hearing and for all those people who testified. The news we got during the process of the hearing was heartening, and look forward to working with you to get the details and to promote legislation in that area. It's a vitally important industry for New York State, and we haven't done enough for it. I would just say that as we move to go back, and I fully support going back to a not-for-profit like NYRA, don't go back to the days of when I served in the Assembly. We had some problems where the president was making $430,000 and the number two guy was making $410,000. That's not going to fly with the public, so we need to keep it within bounds but privatize it. Thank you.
Anyone else have any closing remarks?
I would just like to say thank you to the speakers for coming here today. Thank you for all the time you put into your remarks and all the statistics. Certainly you proved what an important industry horse racing is, certainly in Saratoga and the capital region. You fill hotel rooms not just in Saratoga, but in Lake George and in Albany and in Rensselaer and all through the capital region. And it is critically important that we keep this issue on the forefront. So thank you so very much for being here with us.
Finally, I want to thank you for your sensitivity to the time constraints today that we have. The other thing that I will mention to you, we were trying to read briefly at the same time that people were testifying the governor's press release, but I will say to you that we will do everything in our power to prevent the governor from taking money away from the racing industry. And I promise you that we will work to correct this injustice and punitive arrangement that has happened with the VLTs in Nassau County. We're aware of the reduction of NYRA. We're aware of the Finger Lakes problem when Tyree Casino comes on board. And we promise you we will all work to address any of those inequities. The last thing I want to say is I don't want the governor to interpret this legislative hearing as a fight with him, because I don't want polarization with the governor when it comes to protecting the racing industry, because it's important to the governor, it's important to us, and it's important to everyone that benefits from the racing industry to work together. And I'm hoping that this legislative hearing just raises his sensitivity as to the priorities, and he will look to work with us as we work together to resolve the issues that have come before us today. I thank you very much, and I'm going to conclude this racing committee hearing. It's now 10 to 1. Thank you very much for
coming.
Okay? Thanks, Joe.